morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Now you're awake. Okay, good morning for those who are watching us online. Thank you for coming on a long, long weekend with finally hot weather. We appreciate you guys coming here today. So today our lecture is going to be done by Teresa. It's about selfishness. We know that it's going to be for the others because we don't have that in us. We are all evolved spirits, enlightened, and we don't need to learn that. But before we start that, Sandra is going to do the initial reading and prayer for us.
Good morning. Very happy to be here with all of you. Today's reading is from the book Happy Life, Givaldo Pereira Franco by Joana de Angelis. You may not know it, but you are an example for someone. There are always people observing your actions, even the mistaken ones, and aligning themselves with them. You are thus responsible not only for what you do, but also for what your ideas and attitude inspire in other individuals. Dictators and arbitrary people by themselves would never accomplish anything were it not for those who think like them and to support them. By the same token, good works would disappear were it not for those people who identify with them through sacrifice and love. Be careful what you say and do. Encourage followers to elevate themselves and to act correctly. So let's elevate our thoughts to God, our Creator, to Jesus, our Master of Love, our Guiding Light. And with our heart filled with gratitude, we thank them for the opportunity to be here today. Let Teresa's words inspire us so we can grow towards this path of light and love that is where God and Jesus await for us. Let those words inspire us to become a better person. And we thank all the spirits, incarnate and discarnate ones, they are here with us today. Be with us. So be it.
So be it.
Thank you.
Actually, there's more people than expected on a weekend, summer day, finally, like Raquel said. So thank you all for being here. So we are going to be talking about selfishness today. And it's something that is very important for us to talk about. And why it's important for us to talk about selfishness. As per the spirits that helped Kardec to write the books, especially the Gospel According to the Spiritism and the Spirits book, they say very clear that selfishness, and actually selfishness and pride, which is hand in hand, like twin sisters, as they go, you know, hand in hand all the time, they are the root of every single vice that we have. So they say that if you analyze every single kind of vice that we carry inside of us, it can be vanity, it can be greed, intolerance, impatience, no matter what, if you really do a deep searching, what's behind my vanity, what's behind my intolerance, what's behind my impatience, we all gonna get to selfishness. So if now we know that our vices, it's what leading to all the suffering that we see around us in the world, then it becomes very important, if not anything, becomes urgent, that we start to talk about selfishness. Right? Because when you look around the world, we are, and you could look at the just what's happening right here around us, when we look to this planet as a whole planet, we see that all pain and suffering that we have around there is due to greeding, is due to intolerance, religious, cultural, whatever it is. It's due to selfishness. So we want a better world, we want to be in a better place, I want to find my inner peace. Well, we're going to all have to work on our selfishness. And selfishness comes in many, many different formats and shades. Some of them don't even look selfishness, but actually they are. So what we're going to be talking about today is a little bit about what is selfishness. What's the difference between selfishness and self-love? Because that's very important, actually. We're going to see today how important it is for us to make this distinguish between self-love and selfishness. Because they're two completely different things. One's extremely important that we have, which is self-love, and the other one we need to try to get rid of. How to recognize it in me? Because very easy to recognize on the odds. Oh, so-so is so selfish. Cannot believe. Also, so is so jealous. Oh, this person is always jealous of me. Or this person is so greedy. But we very rarely say, oh, I'm jealous. I'm a jealous person. I'm selfish. Or at least I was selfish on that situation. And even when we recognize ours, it always comes with a but. Oh, I was selfish yesterday. But it was because, ours comes with a justification. The others never comes with a justification. So how do we recognize it inside of us? And we're going to be talking about what's the Spiritism role in this matter? How Spiritism can help us in this matter of selfishness. So let's start talking about what is selfishness and what's the difference between self-love and selfishness. Okay. So self-love is when you know yourself and you accept yourself with your lights and shadows. So I look at myself, I recognize I have good things in me, you know, but I also recognize my shadows. And I accept the way I am. I don't get my shadows and just use that to beat myself up and say I'm a bad person, I don't deserve anything, I'm so selfish and I'm this and I'm that. No, the person who has self-love, they know themselves. They know they're good and bad, and they say, you know what, I need to work on these things. But I accept that that's who I am. I'm not perfect, and I'm far from it, but I'm going to work on my imperfections. That's what someone who has self-love will do. So self-love is actually something that helps us to elevate morally. It helps us actually even to take the selfishness out of us, because I recognize my selfishness, and I say, I'm going to work on it. Maybe tomorrow I'm going to start to help a little bit more in the office, or I'm going to help a little bit more in the home. It's not that I'm going to recognize and make huge changes in my life, but I start to recognize and say, hey, maybe in this kind of situation, I'm going to try to do a little bit better, and we slowly start to change. So self-love is something that helps us to elevate, help us to grow morally. Selfishness is the quite opposite. I don't even know myself. I just know what I like and my own passions, and I only think about myself, what's good for me. And I don't care for the others at all. What's good for me, and I only do things that based on what? Fulfill my own passions. What is good for me, and I don't care what's the price, right? It's completely different. So selfishness is something that instead of elevates us morally, actually stops us. Morally and spiritually, there's no growth. It actually blocks us. We don't go anywhere. So just to give a few examples, so when we love ourselves, we take care of our bodies. And because you know what, it makes me feel good. It makes me feel good if I have a better health, if I exercise a little bit, and I do for myself because it brings me a sensation of well-being, because it's good for me. And as a Spiritist, I know that this body was a very important blessed tool that was given to me to fulfill my journey here as an incarnated spirit. So I do because it is good for me, because it makes me feel better. It makes it go, you know, in a better state in this journey. But when I'm selfish, normally I'll take care of this. But if I take care, first I may not take care of this body because I don't care. I just want what's best for me right now, what feels good right now in this moment. But if I do, usually I do out of vanity. So I don't take care of my body because it's something that makes me feel good at recognizing this. I make it because my body has to be better than someone else's body, because I need to be stronger, because I need to be this, because I always have this super powerful, fantastic body. And then it leads even to certain medical, it can be actually become an addiction. Some people are addicted to exercise, same thing that people are addicted to opioids. So they'll spend like 4 or 5 hours daily, 7 days a week in the gym. Because they're so obsessed that they have to have the body, because I need to look better than everybody else. So that's now, it's not self-love anymore, that's actually vanity. And if you look at the advantage, what it is? Selfishness. Because I need to be better than the others. I don't do something just because it's good for me, but it's just because I need to be better than the others. I need to be, have a better body. So see the difference? Self-love and selfishness. When we love ourselves, we also take care of our mental health. We take a good care of mental health. We use our intelligence to bring good things around us, to bring good thoughts, to maybe be a little more positive, even through the hardship. That's what we do. And when we think we're not doing well, we look for help. You know, we look for a system. We're going to do psychotherapy or do whatever it is. But I take care of my mental because I want to be healthy. Because I know if I'm healthy here, I can distribute to health to the people around me. So that self-love, we need to take care of our mental, which is actually in some ways taking care of our spiritual side, right? Very important, because I know it's good for me, because if I don't let myself go down in depression, that's going to be good for me. And then in a better state, mental state I am, the more I can give around. If I'm selfish, I usually only use my mental and intellectual capacities to fulfill my own desires and passions. And sadly enough, I would say probably, if not 100%, very close to 100%, we do at the cost of our mental health. I would just fulfill my, all my mental and everything that I think and everything that I, all this intellectual capacity that I have, it, I'm just gonna use to fulfill my own desires. It could be greedy for money, it could be sexual desires, it could be just that position that I want in the company, and I don't care what I'm gonna step on, but I'm gonna get it. And that's what I use my mental capacity for. The problem is that when we live a life like that, we really sacrifice our mental health. Because eventually, sooner or later, we're all gonna end up in depression, we're gonna end up in sorrow, pain, dissatisfaction. So dissatisfaction, but I'm satisfying all my desires. Yeah, but then you satisfy this one, and then you wanted the next one, and then the next one, and then the next one. And I'm never happy, because I literally, to fulfill my desires, I sacrifice my mental health. And then we become the kid, you're in a sandbox, and there's two kids, and there's 10 toys in the sandbox. And this one kid has the 9 toys, and it's unhappy. It's like, I have the 9 toys. And there's this one kid has 1 toy, the crappiest one. It's a little car that actually has no wheels, but he decided, no, okay, I'll play, that's a boat. And he's all happy there with the one crap toy, and he's all happy. And this one kid with the 9 toys is unhappy, because he looks to that kid and say, no, but I want that toy. And until I don't get that toy, I'm not happy. But you already have 9 toys. But no, but I want that one. But that's a crap one. I don't care, I want that one. Because maybe if I get that one, I'm gonna be as happy as that kid it is. Because actually I'm jealous of the happiness that kid has with 1 toy, when me with 9 cannot do it. And that's what a selfishness can lead us to. To be so greedy for things that just fulfill my own desires. There will be that person who's never satisfied. Even though I satisfy all my desires, I'm always dissatisfied. That's a perfect recipe for depression, pain, sorrow, and everything. That's what the selfishness leads us. Difference between self-love and selfishness. Right? It's very important for us to distinguish this. So in sum, self-love, it's what elevates us. It's what helps us to know ourselves and elevate us morally. And selfishness is exactly the opposite. It's what stagnates us, is what does not give us the sense of well-being. And it's bringing the sensation of loneliness, because if I'm extremely selfish, that's what I'm gonna do eventually. I'm gonna be lonely, because I only think about myself, and I just separate myself from everybody else. And it stops our moral growth. And the truth is, only when we start to love ourselves is when we're gonna start to be able to love the others. Because I cannot give what I don't have inside of me. If I cannot even love myself and find the love inside of me, how am I gonna be loving the others? How am I gonna extend that? How am I gonna have the self-love when I'm gonna know myself and say, hey, I have these shadows, I need to work on this a little bit. And then when we're working a little bit on our shadows, now I start to be a little more charitable. I need to practice even more the laws of love and charity, and that's when the moral growth comes. So we need to love ourselves. We need to have self-love if we want to start to love the others. So very important to have this distinguish between selfishness and self-love. We need to find our self-love if we want to stop our selfishness. And that's why Jesus said, love your neighbor as you love yourself. Because if you don't even love yourself, it's almost impossible to love someone else. Why it's so hard for us to fight selfishness in this life here? One of the reasons why reincarnated it's so hard to fight selfishness in us is because selfishness and materialism are intimately connected. And we're now here incarnated on this planet. It is a very materialistic planet, where as society, and comes from the way we educate our kids in school, to the way society runs, our laws and everything, the way our media goes, it is meant to be materialistic. Right? You're not cool if you don't have this car. You're a loser if you don't use this clothes. You know, and it really leads us to become more and more materialistic. And the more materialistic we are, the more selfish. But we need to think here very clearly, because we always like to blame the external cause, right? Also, see, the materialism leads me to be selfish. And that's just not true. That's not true at all. It's our selfishness that lets us to be materialistic. Okay? Because if I don't have selfishness inside of me, or my selfishness, I know I worked quite a bit on it, it's very slow, the less I give importance to material stuff, right? So you can present whatever it is to me, it doesn't catch me. I don't need to have that car. It doesn't matter what you do to me. Like, I'm happy with what I have, right? And that doesn't mean that I shouldn't work to have a better life or to have a better lifestyle. That's not what we're saying. But what we're saying is that I cannot live just for that, right? That's the problem. There's nothing wrong. I have a better car. There's nothing wrong with that. But what I do with that is just to show off. Or actually, what is because, you know, I like it. And with that, I can even help people around with my car, right? Or no, you know, I won't take people with my car. Like, it could damage my car, you know? So what I do with that, what I do with all the material things that we acquire, that's the difference. So there's nothing wrong. Because there is a law, it's the law of conservation. So the law of conservation makes us to want to have clothes to protect us in the winter time. It helps us, you know, to have shelter above our heads and, you know, have comfort. Because it is, it's part of the law of conservation. So there's nothing wrong that I have, you know, I want a better house or I want a better car. There's nothing wrong with that. The problem is when that's just become our sole goal. That's the only goal that I have, is to acquire material stuff. And I don't use everything that I acquire to help the ones around me and extend even to the others beyond that. Because a lot of times I'm very good to help my family here or my friends, but I can never go beyond that. That's a type of selfishness as well. It's very easy to help the people that you love. And how about helping the people that you don't even know? Or the people that you don't like? Love your enemies. That's what Jesus said, very hard, right? So that's why it's so hard for us to disconnect from materialism and working on ourselves. So imagine we us here, all in perfect spirit, in the level of moral evolution that we are, that's very low, to be honest. That's how they describe to us, the spirits describe to us. And now you're incarnated in a very materialistic planet. It makes very hard to work on our selfishness inside of us. It is. That's why the change has to be slow. Okay, we recognize that shadow. I won't make any big change, but I'll do a small one. I will, you know, I'll start with that one person that I don't like at work, and I'll try to have a better relationship with this person, help a little bit more this person. That's it. You know, start with one little thing. We have a very famous example in history of selfishness, and it's funny because for the longest time, I never thought this is a selfishness, so almost like an omission than a selfishness, until I had to prepare this lecture. And the example of Pontius Pilate. So there's a very famous story that everybody knows, right? So Jesus has been arrested. Pontius Pilate takes him in front of the crowd, brings another criminal, like a known criminal, puts them both together, and asks the crowd, I'll save one of them, which ones you guys want to save and which ones you guys want me to crucify. And they say, crucify Jesus. And he even says, but why him? He has done nothing wrong. He hasn't even helped you guys. He only did the good. Like, why him? And they said, that's him that wanted to be killed. And then he does the famous scene that we all use this expression until today. He washed, so well, I wash my hands. I have nothing to do with that. Do whatever you want. If you do a superficial analysis, it's looking like, wow, nice, this is democracy, right? It's democracy. He asked, let's cast the votes, let's do an election here, whatever you guys choose, that's what it goes, democracy, right? It's beautiful, yeah, nice. There's only thing, this is 2,000 years ago, and let's be very clear, there's no democracy 2,000 years ago, not in that time. He had full power to decide whatever he wanted in that moment. Full power. He could call the guards and say, you know, take all these people away. They're crazy. I'm not going to crucify this guy. He's clearly innocent. I'm not going to do this. This is wrong. This is absolutely wrong. I'm not going to do it. And by the other guy is a convicted criminal. It's obviously who I have to crucify and who I shouldn't, right? When he says, I'm washing my hand, he actually, what he's doing is something, it's another phrase we all like to use sometimes, is what's in it to me? Because I'm pretty sure before he washed his hand, he went through his mind and said, what's in it for me? What do I have to gain here? Do I gain anything if they kill him? No. Do I lose anything if they kill him? No. Actually, if anything, and what if this people has been bugging me for so long, because they wanted me to crucify and arrest this guy for so long, that if I don't do this right now, they're probably gonna keep bugging me and bugging me and bugging me. No, let's end this craziness now. So actually, when he washed his hands, what he did was pretty much saying, well, there's nothing in it for me. I have nothing to gain. This is just a poor carpenter that goes around and helps poor people. Like these people that we don't even consider people, right? What's the difference? Because if it was a wealthy guy with political powers, oh, then he would have no problem to choose his political power that he had at the moment and say, not at all. Because see, well, this guy probably can get me even a higher position than I have right now. Like, I'm not gonna do anything against this guy. But there's nothing there for him. No gain. So you know what? I wash my hands. So it looks an omission, right? I'm just omitting myself, but it's not. It was an act of selfishness. How many times we do that? I have nothing to do with that. So I'm not gonna get involved. Right? I wash my hands. Or how many times when someone asks us for something, we have said, what's in it for me? But there's nothing there for me. I'm not gonna help it. I'm not gonna get involved in it. That's selfishness. That's what Pontius Pilate did at the time. Of course, at the time, he didn't know that actually there was something for him to lose, right? But he was ignorant. He didn't understand. And that's actually the biggest cause of selfishness. 2,000 years ago, and this day is the ignorance of the past and the future. Because I'm pretty sure if Pontius Pilate at the time knew that whatever he had done in that life would dictate what would happen in his spiritual life, on his next life, he would have chosen a little bit better. It's like, no, this is wrong. I'm going to do what is just. Because right? He recognized the injustice in that moment. But because for him on that moment made no difference, he said, I don't care for the injustice that's been made here. I'm just going to, you know, walk away. But if he knew, he wouldn't do that. If he knew what would be the consequence, he wouldn't do that. But he only saw the life as that one life, right? When I die, nothing happens, right? He thought about his status at that moment, that's what he thought. If he knew that whatever power he had, political status, money, would count for nothing at the moment that he had disconnected, he wouldn't have done what he did. And it's the same with us today. If we fully understand what's the consequence of what's happening when we disconnect, that we're going to be accountable for everything that we have done, that will dictate what's going to happen with us once we disconnect, we would probably start to work on our selfishness for sure. And in fact, Emmanuel in the book Living Spring says, If the selfish persons could see the hellish loneliness that awaits for them, they would never be apart from the incessant practice of charity and mutual cooperation. Hellish loneliness. That's what happens to people who are extremely selfish. They isolate them so much, and they don't need to discriminate to find the Mary's talking about like what's going to happen when they discriminate. But the truth, some of them, we don't need to discriminate to see this. How many people lead such a selfish life, and a lot of times through greed they reach high levels of material status and life, and live a completely isolated life because they don't have true friends. Most of people around them are just like them, just, you know, are around them because they can gain something from them. They don't have true friends. A lot of times they disconnected from family because to fulfill their passions, they pushed everybody away. And they end up sometimes, yeah, the good life, the happy life, that is so-called. They have lots of things, partying, this and that. But they are actually lonely. Inside, there's only emptiness. And then that's what Manuel says. That if we understood what awaits for them on the other side due to selfishness, would never be apart from charity and mutual cooperation. Because we really understand the consequence of it. So I'm going to bring a little story from the book, Jesus in the Home. I really love this book. I actually was meant to bring it here so I could show you guys the cover. It's a small book. It has about, like, I think, 50 chapters. And each chapter is very short, and it's basically stories that brought to us. It's by by Chico Xavier, by the spirit of Anil Lucius. And basically what Anil Lucius described, it's meetings that Jesus used to have with the apostles at the end of the day at Simon Peter's house. This was actually the first church, the first Christian church, because at the time, the word church, that's what it meant. It's a group of people that were united on someone's house, and they would talk about things. So this is the book, Jesus in the Home. It's a short book. It's big letters, so great. And each chapter is about 45 pages, so it's really short, right? So he would meet with the apostles at the end of the day, and each chapter is a conversation they were having. And usually the story itself starts with the apostles either asking him a question, or they argue against them, like, you know, they talk with them about some subject, and then Jesus calmly just goes and puts his word in there. And he always tells a story. And that's very cool because Jesus always tells them a story to exemplify what they're talking about. He always tells a little story. And they're always very simple. And it's always concepts of the gospel. And the stories are so simple, it's like, oh, now I got it. I get it. So it's a fantastic book. I really recommend. So in chapter 16, it's actually called Mutual Help. And the story that Jesus tells, it really shows us very, very clear where the path of selfishness takes us and where the path of mutual help, so the path of charity, takes us. So it tells the story of these two old friends. They have been long-time friends, and they're walking into the mountains, and they are in a very bad weather. They are both freezing. They are almost freezing to death at this point. They are sick. They're very sick, and they're trying to reach this village, the nearest village, so they can actually find shelter and survive. But there's a very, very slim chance that they're actually going to get to the next village alive. Okay? They are really in their last straw of warmth in their bodies, energy. They're sick. They're not really doing well. And as they're walking, they see a child on the ground, almost dead, because the child also is also now almost freezing to death. The older of them looks at the child and say, oh, no, I'm sorry, there's nothing we can do about this child. Let's leave the child there, because there's nothing we can do. Like, we almost die here. We have no energy to carry ourselves. Like, we don't even know if we're going to make it. If we carry this child, we're not going to make it, right? There is no way. I'm just gonna walk. I have nothing to do with that. Let's just gonna go. I'm just gonna save myself because that's what I can do right now. That's the only energy that I have for now. That's what I'm gonna do. And that's what he does. The youngest of the two says, no, we cannot leave this child here. This child is gonna die. We cannot do that. So he grabs this child, puts against his chest, and starts to carry this child. with a lot of effort, he actually reached the next village with the child. They found a guest house where they're giving dry clothes, food, some fire to warm themselves, and he knows his friend's not there. And in fact, the next day, the body of his friend is found, and he froze to death trying to reach the village. And the reason the guy with the child was able to reach this village is because the little warmth there was in the body of this child, with the little warmth that he had added to each other, and it was enough to take them safely to the village. So his act of charity and love and compassion at that moment is actually what saved him. Because if he had acted exactly like the other one had acted, all three had died. The child would die, he would die, the other guy was gonna die. Because he had a moment of compassion and charity there in the moment, he actually saved himself and helped to save the child. The other, because thought, you know, I only have a little bit and I'm gonna keep it because this I need it, end up dying. Because you need a little bit more than the little that he had to make it. It was the little the child could give to them in that moment. And that's what happens. Selfishness leads us to this path of death, not death of body or anything, not literal, but the moral death. Because we end up alone and stuck in nowhere. And that's the death that even Jesus has referred in the gospel, right? When he says, you know, you're going to be like a living dead. That's what he's talking about. Yeah, I'm going to still alive, but dead inside with emptiness. But charity leads us to actually help one another, and then we can make it. As a Spiritist, I always like to joke, like, oh, when I discover, I want to get to nosso lar. Yeah, okay, good, so let's start helping each other. Because if you want to get to there, we're not going to get there alone. I'm not going to say, oh, you know, I'm too busy, I have to get to nosso lar, I'm going to go on my own, it's not going to happen. Because if we don't help each other, we're not going to get in any place that great on the other side. I'm going to be alone. And in the Gospel, according to the Spiritism, that's exactly what they describe. They say, why do most of the time we're so selfish in here? That most of people are selfish are people who suffer the consequence of someone else selfish. And then what I do is like, you know what? They're just fending for themselves. I'm going to fend for myself as well. So someone, you know, this person, so no, I also want to care for myself. And that's, I start to act with the next one, and then the next one, let's go. And then how are we going to end up? All dying. In the middle of the way, because the storm is big. And I don't need to say this to anybody, because we all carry our own storms, and we all have to walk through the mountains in this incarnated life. So if you don't start to give hand in hand and walk together, we all not gonna make to the guest house. That's what it is. So what's the role of the Spiritism in this matter? I think we all pretty much touched it already. What's the role of Spiritism in this matter? So what Spiritism does is actually bring us the knowledge. So the notion of life after death and reincarnation, the concept that our spiritual life will have a consequence of everything that we have done in here. It's going to be a consequence of everything that we've done in here. So now we're not going to think about it anymore on this moment, because, oh, okay. Yeah, I could wash my hand now, but if I wash my hand now, oh, there's a consequence, so I'm not going to wash my hand now. I'm actually going to start to work and do something, right? So when the Spiritism brings us this knowledge that, hey, we actually have many lives, and what's happening right now, it's a consequence of what came before, so that's why you're walking through the storm, through the mountains, because something that happened in here, right? But also, if you don't start holding hands and make a bigger end here at the end of this mountain, well, guess what? This is going to impact on your spiritual life after and on the next life as well. So now I start to say, oh, maybe I need to work on my selfishness. Because literally, if when we have this idea, it's just this life, as many of us out there has, right? It's just this. It's one life, period. So that's what leads us to think, let's live the moment. Isn't that what we have the motto? Let's live in the moment, you know? Life's short. Let's do everything now. Life is short. Well, there's one problem. Life is not short. Life is infinite. We are all immortals. So it's way, way, way longer than we can expect it, you know? And it's continuous. What I did now, We dictate what we're going to have here, that's going to dictate what's going to happen here. Incarnated or discarnated, it's continuous, right? So that's what Spiritism does. It brings us the knowledge. So means the, so it doesn't take, so Spiritism doesn't uproot the selfishness from inside me. I have to do that. It's my own job. My inner transformation is mine. But Spiritism brings me the knowledge, like, oh, now I understand why I have to take the selfishness now. Why it's important for me not just to live the moment. Why it's important for me to just not fulfill my own desires and wishes and actually think about a little bit more around the people around me. Right? Because that's going to have consequence. It's not that when I die, it's like it doesn't matter. Right? The other knowledge that Spiritism brings to us that's very important is this, because remember how selfishness and materialism is intimately connected? It's actually Spiritism brings the knowledge saying, hey, you know all this money that you're acquiring, house, clothes, and everything, your body, everything, is temporary. It does not belong to us. It's just a temporary loan. It's just giving to you while you're here. And then when it's time to go, it's going to stay behind. It is going to stay behind. There's no use. Your social position, your CEO of the company, nobody's going to ask on the other side, hey, I'm sorry, what's your position on your company? Oh, you're the CEO, that's great. What's your salary? How many houses do you have? How many? Nobody's going to ask you that. What was your title? How about your novel? They're just going to say, hey, what did you do with everything that we gave to you while you were there? How many good you did? How many bad? What's the kind of sentiment that you brought to you from there? That's what's going to be asking of us. And that's what's going to count. So when Spiritists bring us this knowledge that those are just temporary tools given to us, does not really belong to us, it helps us to start this detachment from material stuff and start to give a different value to it. Because they do have a value. That's the thing. They do have a value. But we start to give them the right value. And we start to use them to our own well-being, self-love, in a self-love way, but also to spread well-being to everybody else around us. To spread the good to everybody else. So it's not just to fulfill my desires, but it's to help all of us as a society. So it's up here, great, okay, I understand. I need to love myself, I need to know myself, I have to uproot this. So, you know, I have to work on my selfishness, that's where selfishness is gonna lead to me, that's where charity is gonna lead to me. But how can I recognize selfishness inside of me? Because it's hard. And it's hard because it's painful. It's very painful. When you really start to look inside of yourself and do a, you don't need to be like a super deep analysis, but you just go a little more than superficial, it starts to hurt already. Because we start to look inside of us and find stuff that's like, oh, it doesn't look as good as I thought it was, right? I have way more things to work inside of me than I thought. I'm way more jealous than I think. I was never thought of myself of being jealous, but you know what? I am jealous that so-so has a new dress. I'm so-so that I'm jealous that person has a better body than me. Right? It's very hard because a lot of times, I was watching this lecture in Brazil, and this guy was telling about this, and it was not a Spiritist lecture, but he's talking about this research that he did. And they ask people, say, are you jealous? And 90% of, no, they first ask people, do you think that people are jealous of you? 90% of them say, yes, people are jealous of me. But when they ask them, are you jealous? Only 35% said, yes, I am jealous. If 90% think I'm jealous of me, then who's jealous of who here? Because if everybody thinks that everybody's jealous of me, so it means we're all jealous of each other, but then when you ask, are you jealous, saying, no, I am not, the math is not adding up in here. So very easy to recognize on the others, not easy to recognize on us. So how do we do that? Right? How we do this process? So in the Spirit's book, question 919, actually Spirit's book, I think, starts on question 912 or 911, starts to talk about selfishness. That's what Kardec is asking about. You know, what's the main roots of our imperfections? And the Spirit's, I love those when the Spirit's book says, as we already told you guys, selfishness and pride is the roots of all your vices, right? And then he has all the questions. And then finally on 919, Kardec says, okay, so but how do we do to recognize, how we do to improve ourselves, right? And the spirit that gives the answer is the spirit of St. Augustine. And he gives his recipe. He had a very interesting recipe. It's very simple on the recipe itself. I think very hard to apply, but you know, it is actually very interesting. So he starts his answer and he says, the answer is very, very long. I'm just gonna actually read the recipe parts that he gives, right? But what he says is, first he says, well, there is an antique philosopher that already gave you this answer. It's called Know Thyself, right? And that's, you can even apply this, you can even assign this either to Plato or Socrates, it's like depending where you go on the source. So what he says is that, he said, you know what, know thyself. And what I did to know myself when I was incarnated on earth is every night when I went to bed, I asked myself whether or not I had failed to fulfill some duty and whether or not anyone might have had reason to complain about me. So did I did anything that could have offended someone, or that someone could say, oh, why not? St. Augustine could have helped me a little bit more. Didn't do it. Did I did something that was, no, it could had done better, did better. So he would go through all his day, like all the activities that he had through the day, and he would question himself. And said, that's how I end up knowing myself. And he said, and then you can say, okay, but I can look through my day and see, well, you know, yeah, I could have done this, but you know, I didn't do because, so we can kind of start to find an excuse, or maybe be hard. It's hard for to look through our day and really realize what I did right or wrong. And he goes further, he says, those who every night would recall all their actions during the day and would ask themselves what good or evil they have done, praying to God and their guardian angel to enlighten them, would acquire great strength for self-improvement, because believe me, God will assist them. So let's ask them their assistance before we start to do the self-analysis. Now, help me to go through my day and really do analysis. And if you keep doing this every day, you know, even if you can do maybe once a week, let's look back to the week, you know, and ask for this help. They will help us to enlighten us. And then all of a sudden it's going to go, oh yeah, there's the thing that I did. But why did I do it? You know, and go after that. Anyway, it says, therefore, ask yourselves about what you have done and toward what aim you acted in a particular circumstance. So here's the point. We see selfishness as the person who does not help people. And that's not true. There's a lot of selfish people helping people around out there. And we see the cherub is the person who helps, and the selfish is the person who doesn't help everybody. But that's actually not true. I can help someone all the time just because there's something in it for me. Because every time I help this person, they give me a nice gift. So I'm using their generosity. Is that not selfishness? I'm doing because there's something in it for me. And that's what St. Augustine would do. He didn't just analyze, because we think that I should analyze my day and see what I did wrong. No, he would analyze everything. He would even analyze his good actions. He says, with each aim, I did that action. Why did I help this person? Did I do because I really did out of a charity, or did I do because there was something in it for me? Because I had a gain on it. Because that's also a selfishness, when we just do things to help people because there's something in it for me. That's an act of selfishness. Right? So he analyzed everything. It's not only his bad deeds or his wrong deeds. He analyzed even his good deeds, why I did them. Right? So it's a way more profound analysis that we have to do here when we're doing this self-analysis. Right? So whether you have done anything that you would blame in others, and whether you have done anything that would not dare profess. So have I done something that if someone else had done to me, I would blame them? Because if I hadn't, do to the others like you like to be done to yourself, right? Or something that I wouldn't even have the courage to tell someone that I did it, right? So that's what he would look. said, also ask if it pleased to God to call me at this moment to enter the world of spirit, where nothing is hidden, because once we disconnect, nothing's hidden. So to God says, Teresa, it's right now. You going. I'm calling you back. Right? Where nothing is hidden, would I cower before anyone's gaze? Would I be able to lift my head up there? Or I would be like head down because I don't even dare to expose myself from all the selfishness that I have done or not. So ask ourselves, if I go now, like this very, I'm not saying that, oh no, I can't go because I'm perfect. No, but if I go now, in general, can I, and am I happy with what I left behind, more or less? Right? So that's the questions that you do. Simple recipe, not easy to follow, but it's a simple recipe. That's how he knows himself, and that's how we will know ourselves, by analyzing our actions, by analyzing what we have done, by analyzing every single action, the good ones and the bad ones. And then we act upon it, right? Because I can just do that. So he, next day, he would wake up and try to do better, right? Because just analysis, if you don't stop in analysis, then it's missing a piece on the process. I recognize, and then I act upon it. So the only way to approach selfishness from inside us is first to recognize it inside of us, and then start to practice the only thing that can help us to take it out of us. It's called charity. And that's why in the Spiritist, we always say that without charity, there is no salvation. Because that's the only way. It's only by helping each other. It's only through mutual help is that we're gonna make it, is that we're gonna be in a little better state, is that we all gonna reach that inner peace that we all look for so badly. So without charity, there's no salvation. I just wanna end this lecture today with a little story. And it's very simple, very, very simple story. But to me, it's so powerful in so many ways that I think the day that I truly understand the essence of the story, then I'll be a completely different person. Some of people, you know, that very recently Marcia and I had gone to Madagascar to a mission. And while we were there, in one of our meetings that we had with the whole group, with the founder of, we went to this nonprofit called Fraternity Without Borders. And the founder of Fraternity Without Borders was there. And we were talking about the philosophy that's behind the this nonprofit. And they told us a little story. So first thing, one of the first philosophy is, we don't help because most of the work is done in Brazil and in Africa, and most targeting children that's malnourished and die of starvation. And first thing that we have is like, we don't help them because they're poor, we don't help them because they're in need. We help them because they are brothers and sisters. And that to me was the first wake up. So like, because that changed completely. When you start to see each other as brothers and sisters, we no longer see as someone from a different culture, different religion, nothing. We just really start to see ourselves as one big community. But while we were there, they spoke with us about something that can be called a religion or philosophy, an African religion and philosophy that's called Ubuntu. And to explain to us what Ubuntu is, they told us this real story about the scientist that went to this small village in Africa because he wanted to do a research about the African culture, religions, and habits, and everything. So he wanted to know a little bit more about the culture. So he decided to do a social experiment with the children. And what he did, he got a bunch of chocolate and put it far away and put it close to a tree. And then he put the kids on the other side. And he told the kids, okay, when I say go, whoever gets to the tree first gets the chocolate, right? So, okay, the kids like, okay, sure. So he goes, go. When he said go, the children held hands and walked together to the tree. I can tell the story 2,000 times and I'll always get choked. They all held hands and they walked to the tree and divided the chocolates in equal parts. To this experiment here to see what would happen. They would elbow each other just to show that I am. And honestly, our children here have access to chocolate. They don't even need to run for the chocolate. They could say, oh, no, I can go home and eat chocolate. My mom can buy a chocolate. They don't even. But just to say, I'm the coolest. I'm the champion. I run better. Like, whatever. But those children held hands, walked together, and divided the chocolate in equal parts. This guy was beyond shocked. Beyond shocked. What? Like, he was so puzzled that he'd go to the children and say, and he asked them and said, why did you do that? And one of the children looked at him and said, Ubuntu. And he goes, what's Ubuntu? He said, how can I be happy if my brothers and sisters are not happy? So it's very, like, the day we understand this is the day that we're going to understand love your neighbor as you love yourself. Thank you.
You should have said that in the beginning. So we still have a couple minutes for questions or comments if anyone would like to say something, ask something, or anyone online too. No?
Okay.
Thank you very much. Oh, Sandra, sorry.
you're right. Like, we live in a world that is a selfish world because we are still very selfish. So recognizing that we have that in us is the first step. I am selfish, yeah. Maybe I am selfish. I don't want to see why I am selfish. But life and our actions, it will teach us. Some people say, oh, they come to the spirit center, but they, oh my God, no, I better go back to church because here I do know myself a little better. And once you take out that filter out of your eyes, you deal with something, a little word that is called responsibility.
Yes.
Towards yourself and towards the other, no matter who those other are. And also, Spiritism teaches us that this is a school. Mm-hmm. So for those who wants to know what your actions are and what you're going to be in your next life and what am I going to be, just look what you're doing now. What are your limitations today? And what do you want to accomplish? You know, what do you want to really grow in this life? And sometimes we feel, oh, I have to go to Madagascar, you know, I have to work with something, I have to give myself. Maybe we are in a position that just not wishing bad to somebody yes. that hurt us is good enough for this moment.
Yeah. Or just help my own family.
Yeah, you know, yeah. And maybe I can help the one that did bad to me, but I can pray for him. So small little steps, it's very important that we take it and we don't put this huge and high expectations that I want to be something. Because if I can't go and work with a nonprofit in charitable works, or if I can't, so I'm not even going to try, not even this small little one. So recognizing our own limitations, it's beautiful for us to grow, to give this step that we need, that maybe in 2 or 3 or 4 thousand lifetimes, I'll be somebody that I am, that I'm aspiring to be more and more towards loving my brothers and sisters. But this is the school.
Yes.
And being here today takes this filter out of our eyes and we say, yes, I'm better than this. You know, like I did this, I wish badly to somebody. No, I'm better than this. I'm gonna try not to do this anymore. Or at least I'm recognizing that I'm doing bad today. So all these are little steps towards being a better person, a better, you know, to grow morally as a spirit.
For those who never read the book, Action and Reaction, it gives us like a scope to why am I going through some expiations or through some hardships in this life, and takes us out of that victimization that put us in, you know, or maybe just accepting life hard, just give us the strength to keep moving forward. So it's, that's how I feel. I'm still very selfish in a lot of things, but I believe that I've been growing, and I think getting these filters and the responsibilities of doing a little bit better every day, it makes me feel better about myself. And when you have that feeling that you feel better about yourself, is the best feeling that you can have.
Exactly. And I think we all have something to give. We all have, if it's a small thing, we all have the goodness inside of us. None of us is 100% bad. So all of us have the goodness inside of us.
No, as the initial
prayer says,
reading said, you know, we are inspiring people, the good or the bad.
Exactly.
You are responsible for your actions, for your words. So just remember this, you know, like if you can get something out of this today,
exactly.
It's the word selfishness, responsibility, and your actions, and your what am I inspiring today?
And
am I inspiring beauty? Am I inspiring positivity? Am I inspiring negativity? What is that I'm inspiring today?
One thing that you said that I think is really important, sometimes as a spirit that I do that myself when I'm studying the gospel on Wednesdays, is first is acknowledgement, right? So in order for you to change, you need to acknowledge you have something that needs to be changed. Otherwise, like, you're never going to see that. And the second thing that sometimes for me is hard is like, the more you study Spiritist, the more you think you are behind, and the more you think that you have to go faster, because I have the knowledge, so I should do something. And we forget that the reason we are here is because we are imperfect and we need to change. And if we try to conquer the world once at once, we're going to fail. So like, pick one thing, as Teresa said in her lecture, right? Choose one thing and fix that one thing. And then you move to the next one and the next one. Otherwise, like, we feel that we are failing on everything. And then that's the pathway to depression and like disaster for sure.
Because our transformation has, and tagging what you said, it has to be on our own pace.
Yeah.
And my pace may be different than someone else's pace. And we have to also remember that we all have something good to give. And then like Sandra saying, oh, I'm still selfish, I'm still as well. But you know what? Maybe you're selfish in some aspects that I am not, and vice versa. So I get a little bit of your warmth with my little bit of warmth, and I can learn with you to be a little bit selfish on the situations that I am, and maybe Sandra can learn with me to be a little bit selfish on where she is. So that's what we do, a little bit of warmth from everybody. We can learn from each other to be a little bit more positive. Because we have to remember, oh, but who am I to help? Like, you know, I'm so imperfect. But if that's what I was, first of all, we'd be doomed. Because waiting for us to be perfect, so then start to help each other, that's not going to help. And if we need to be perfect to start to actually do the good and do something, spread the gospel through actions, then we wouldn't have Jesus coming as a pure spirit and 12 imperfect spirits helping him, because that's what he chose. He chose 12 apostles who were completely perfect. And when you read Jesus in the home, you're gonna see the discussions that the apostles have amongst them. Do you see how it's the same imperfection that we question ourselves? That's why I love this book, right? And that's his apostles, and he chose to actually spread his gospel, right? Because otherwise, what he would do, he would incarnate him and 12 perfect, another 12 perfect spirits. So instead of having one perfect spirit, the governor of this planet, we have 13 perfect spirits, and they would have spread the gospel. That's what he did. He came, took 12 imperfect people, and said, yeah, let's start doing the goodness. And so we all have something inside. We don't need to be perfect to do, and we can do on our own pace, right? But we need to start. Yeah. That's what's important. We need to start knowing ourselves, and then start from somewhere, right?
Sure.
And it's so perfect, this world that we live in, that they send like perfect spirits. Like, he didn't choose the 12 perfect apostles, but he sends not perfect spirits, but close to perfection that they can to come to to this world and reincarnate.
The missionaries, to
be
example.
So the real missionaries that inspire us.
Yes.
That, you know, whenever something happens and we think of Mother Teresa, oh my God, but she was, I can never be a Mother Teresa. No, I can never be her, but I can be inspired. You know, I can never be a Chico Xavier, but I can be inspired by him.
Mm-hmm.
So all these ones that come here, they are much, much more elevated than us, that were giving, they come to inspire us.
Just an example.
You are inspired by someone, it's because that someone has something that you have, otherwise you would not recognize.
Exactly.
So get this, and this is very important too. You talk about shadow, our imperfections, our what to, but we also have accomplished so much already in recognizing our good things that we have, everything that we have that is good. It's also gonna take us, you know, like it will balance out those imperfections that needs
absolutely.
To become lighter in us.
That's for sure.
Anyone else? No? Okay, so we are gonna get ready for our classes. Thank you for those who join us online. We invite you to do your final prayer at home.